Good morning, Chapel Hill.
Good morning.
Whew, that's enthusiastic. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we are called to
rejoice.
Rejoice and be glad in it. We welcome those of you who are watching online. We're so thankful for your presence with us today. And welcome to each of you here in the sanctuary for this special Labor Day weekend service of worship. Special word of welcome to our guests, the Shue family back here. I'll introduce them more formally later, but if you would stand, let's give them a warm Chapel Hill welcome, please. It's a blessing to have you here. These three are incredibly gifted people, and Isaac and his wife Karina are both ceramic artists, and you're going to hear the Word of God come alive today, so thank you for your presence. I have one quick announcement. First of all, did you receive one of these on your way in? They're on the table. If you did not get one, we want you to have one because we're starting our small groups around the Good and Beautiful You series. And so fill it out if you want to be a part of a small group. Neil, raise your hand so people can see you. You can hand it to him or one of the pastors or drop it by the Welcome Center in the Fellowship Hall. Well, we have some music that is going to get the blood flowing if the caffeine didn't do it this morning. So would you stand if you're able as we sing praise to the Lord?
Well, good morning, Chapel Hill. We're going to do a song that you adults might know, but the kids all better know it. I think they do. But you know what? It's really easy. And it's really fun. So let's sing up. If you know it, sing out. Here we go.
This is a morning like no other. Never again will it be here. So let's stop moving. Let's get going. Don't let the daylight disappear.
Yawning, cause it's a good, 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 good morning. It's a good, 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 good morning. Good, 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 good morning. It's gonna be a very good day. Cause you're a good, 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 good God. A good, 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 good God. Good, 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 good God. You are a very good God. Let us remember why we are here today. We're here to sing.
Okay, everybody, you're doing so good with emotions. You can give a fist bump to your neighbors, say good morning, and here we go.
Amen. You guys did so great with that. We're going to sing another one. It's so great to be all together this morning in the same place as a family worshiping our God of grace and love. So let's lift our voices up.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now.
seated. God, we give you thanks this morning that you're always working, that you're always calling out to us, no matter where we are or where we've been, and that your grace is more than enough. So this morning, God, we pray that you would work inside of us, that you would shape us, God, that you would have a way in our souls. So this morning, God, let us open up to what it is you're doing in our lives and welcome you in Jesus' name.
A reading from the 18th chapter of Jeremiah. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my word. So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand, and he reworked it into another vessel that seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done, says the Lord? Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. At one moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy it. But if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will change my mind about the disaster that I intended to bring upon it. And at another moment, I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will build and plant it. If it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will change my mind about the good that I had intended to do it. Now, therefore, say to the people of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, Look, I am a potter, shaping evil against you and devising a plan against you. Turn now, all of you, from your evil way, and amend your ways and your doings. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Grayson. At this time, our ushers are going to bring forward our connection folders, and these are a way of connecting. That's why they're called connection folders. Inside, you'll find pads where you can leave your name, any address changes. The blue pads are for our visitors and first-time guests, and the white are for those of you who consider Chapel Hill your home. You'll also find prayer request cards inside, and we would love to pray with and for you. So you can either fill that out and drop it into the basket, or if it's a very confidential request, you can hand it to one of the pastors after the service. When it gets to the end of the row, just set it down and we'll pick it up after service is over. And now we are about to be so blessed. We're glad to have Maureen Berry with us this morning to sing our special music.
Lord, I offer up this rebel heart, so stubborn and so broken from the start. I don't want to fight you anymore, so take this rebel heart and make it yours. Father, I no longer want to run. You've broken my resistance with your love, drowned it underneath the crimson spill. So bend this rebel heart unto your will. I give it over to you. This rebel heart belongs to you. Help me lay the renegade to rest. Turn the stone inside me back to flesh. Hold me till my best defenses fall. And watch this rebel heart surrender. Give it all over to you. I give it all over to you. Your love is like an arrow, straight and true. And now this rebel heart belongs to you. Oh, take my life and let it be yours. Take my life and let it be yours. Oh, take my life and let your love is true. And now this rebel heart belongs to you. And now this rebel heart belongs to you. And now this rebel heart belongs to you.
Thank you, Maureen. Well, Maureen, thank you for blessing us with that beautiful voice. I think she deserves another round of applause as our way of saying thank you. It's beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Well, I want to invite the children to come down to those sections that are reserved for them so that they can see Isaac do his work. So any children among us who want to come down, make your way now. So hopefully you have picked up on the theme of the day where the prophet Jeremiah, speaking for God, says, I am the potter and you are the clay. So I said to my wife, an artist and a teacher of art, who can I invite to do the work of the potter? She says, well, guess what? There's nobody better than Isaac Shue. In fact, if you could get him, that would be a huge, huge blessing. So, I want to introduce to you Isaac and Karina Shue and their son, Javi. Would you come up here, please? Let people see you, please. Yes, welcome again. We want everybody to be able to see you, even though Karina and Javi may or may not stay. I don't know. I doubt it, but I want you to be able to see them. And Jeremy, did you get my slides? Okay, well, you don't need them, but here's the thing. Their ceramic is incredibly beautiful. It is a genuine work of art. And they both are ceramic artists, and their work is displayed all around the world. And so they wanted to create a space to display their own work and to invite fellow artists to do the same. Well, guess where they're doing it? Harper, Kansas. 45 minutes southwest of Wichita. They're putting Harper on the map by virtue of what they're doing. So Gallery Mostaza, did I say that correctly? And Mostaza, or mustard in English, derives from the Christian parable of the mustard seed, stating that with a small amount of faith, large goals can be met. That's right, Javi. When the word mostava is broken in half with this small yellow mustard seed, as you will see if you go to their website, it's in the logo, there's the second half of the word taza, which means mug, which is the primary thing that they create. So I asked Isaac if he would bring some product with him, and in his humility, he said, no, you can order it through the website or come down to Harper. But that says a lot about him. So we are so blessed to have you three here. And I asked Isaac, again, his humility showing up here. I said, have you ever done something like this before? He said, yes. I said, well, like how many times? Well, probably 20 times. And so thank you for your humility and thank you for your willingness to share your gifts. So congregation, let's give them another warm welcome. Thank you. Okay. Isaac, teach us, please.
Can you all hear me? After that introduction, I don't even know how to do this. That was awesome. Thank you. Before we were artists, I spent 8 years as a public school teacher. And so I should be used to speaking to crowds. However, in churches, you all pay attention. So it's a little different than high school classes. So I do get a little nervous, but bear with me if anything goes wrong. In the Bible, God had people write the Bible in a form of analogy so that we humans can understand what he was trying to get across to us today. And one of the analogies is the potter and the clay. Now we understand like the sheep and the shepherd. Being in Kansas, we're in a farm community. I know Wichita is not. But in Kansas, I'm sure everybody knows a farmer, has seen a farmer, has a pet. They understand the analogy of taking care of a sheep and raising it up and keeping it safe. However, not everybody may understand the analogy of clay and a potter. So I'm going to walk you through the process. Now, clay, I think everybody has seen clay, especially if you've been in an art class. It's kind of a flexible material that bends and molds, but this is not the exact clay that we see. I went out this morning before we came and grabbed some of these chunks of clay off of the property, and this is what clay looks like in the form in the world that a potter, especially in the Bible times, would have to use. Now, I grew up there. I was born in Harper, a mile from where I live, and I spent 35 years there, except for going to college and a time abroad to do some service work. But we came back home, and it reminds me of growing up. We would be in the creek beds running through the rivers and creeks of Harper, and we'd always find these deposits of clay. Now, this clay, we could refer to it as clod. Some people would say a mud clod, where the mud and the clay are actually mixed. So this is not something I can take, put it on a wheel, and create with. But the potter, especially back in the time of Jeremiah, would take this and he would put it in water. Now, when this goes in the water, it gets really, really slippery and it starts to break down. So he would put this in water for probably 3 to 4 months. And what happens is the clay would then separate from the dirt and the clay would drop to the bottom and the dirt would rise to the top. So then he would take the dirt off, he would take all the water off, and the clay would be left kind of in a liquid form, which you'll see on my hands form. It's called slip. So they would get this slip, and then they would push it through a sieve, and that would get any small rocks or anything out of that clay that would make it break in the firing process. What is left is this pure clay, which would be something like this, extremely wet and liquidy. So they would put that in the sun for probably a good 2-3 days, depending on the humidity. And then they would take that and they would wad it up and they would do what's called wedging. And it's kind of like kneading dough on bread. And that would get the clay to where it's actually beneficial for the potter to use. So it's actually a process that takes almost 6 months before the potter can take this and make something from it. Now, we live in a different society where I can go down on South Washington and buy a box of clay and I can make a mug within 10 minutes of getting that clay. So it's a little different than the potters from Jeremiah to where we're at today. But let's just go back to when I was a kid growing up. We would find these clods out in the creek, and something we noticed is they don't like pressure. Okay, when you take a dirt clod and you have pressure on it, it breaks. It does not react to that pressure very well. But after the potter takes his clay and he does the whole transformation to where it is, it's a little bit different. So I'm going to take you into the potter's house and walk you through the workshop of what a potter actually does. So bear with me here as I get things ready and set up. So I'm going to refer to this as clod, and then he will then be transformed into clay throughout the story. So think of me being the potter and this being you, or the clay, the people of God. Okay? So clod then is in the sun, getting dirty, getting hard, and he doesn't like pressure, which we talked about. But when he gets wet, it becomes very slippery. Now, clods are extremely proud of how tough they are, something that we as humans kind of do the same thing. We like to be tough. So they don't like water because as they get wet, they get slippery, and they lose that toughness. And so the clods have been brought up by the potter, put into the water, and he says, "Ooh, I don't like this. This is not what I have been." Goes through the process until the potter gets the clay, starts molding it out and putting the pressure and wedging it into a ball. And he says, "Wow, this is really different. The pressure, I'm not breaking under that pressure anymore. I kind of like where I'm at." He says, "If my friends out in the field could see me now, they would totally make fun of me. But I like this. This is new. This is great." And so the potter, I'm not going to use this one, takes clay, rolls him into a bowl, and remember, clay does not have eyes, cannot see what is going on. He's never seen one of these machines the potter has. Back in Jeremiah's time, they would have had a kick wheel, so they would kick constantly with their foot as they're working. Luckily enough, we do have electricity, which helps me not waste my energy while I am making. So clay is not used to what he's feeling, and all of a sudden, the potter throws clay on the wheel. And once again, he did not break, but he just molded to what the potter was doing. Now, how many of you in the front row have ever been on a merry-go-round? Any of you? Do you get dizzy? Yeah, my kid Javi loves to spin. It's his favorite thing. I don't know how he doesn't get sick. but he loves this idea. Now, Clay does not love this idea because he's getting a little bit woozy, never felt this feeling, and then he feels that familiar wetness and a pressure. And he says, whoa, I like that. He says, I've never really felt this before, but I'm starting to realize that this potter's hands are in control. But if you notice, when I do put pressure on clay, it still gives way, still does what clay wants to. But that pressure from the potter's hands molds clay into what the potter wants, not what clay wants. So as he's sitting here spinning, clay starts thinking, you know, I've heard stories back in clay school when I was still a clod about things like vases and mugs and cups and all these things that clay can be. And he says, you know, I think I'd like to be a vase. And so, just like we as humans, we have our ideas and we do what we would like to do, not always what the potter has in mind. But he decided clay wanted to be a vase. Now, a vase's primary function is to hold probably flowers, some water. It usually has kind of a body in it. It grows pretty tall. But clay's missing something. Does anybody know what clay is missing? Can you stick flowers inside of clay right now? No, there's a little thing missing called a hole. Now, God sent Jeremiah to the house of the potter, not the house of the sculptor. And there was a big reason why God chose the potter. Because sculptors, when they work with clay, they work on the outside. And the potter works from the inside. So every pot is going to start with a hole. Now, once again, clay is not really familiar with this pressure. But he has now become centered on the wheel. Just like we need to become centered when God is working in our lives and do as God says. And then he feels another pressure. He says, whoa, now this is a little bit different than what I'm used to. And the potter started putting what would be the inside of the vase or the bowl or the mug into clay. And now, I don't know if many of you have seen videos. There's a was satisfying, hashtag satisfying. People love the satisfying videos. What happens next on the potter's wheel is kind of that satisfying. Now what it is the potter puts pressure from the inside and from the outside, and clay begins to grow. Now clay remembered, he wanted to be a vase. And so the potter says, that's fine, we'll make you a vase, we can do that. And he starts growing. Now, clay had heard these stories of vases being the biggest thing that a potter makes. There are many different sizes, many different shapes of vases. But the one thing that defines the majority of them is that they are tall. And clay says, yeah, look at me. Starts imagining how big and how tall he's going to be. And slowly starts getting a big head. Now, there are some tall people in this world. But not all of them look down on others. And you don't have to be tall to look down on others. But one thing that clay started doing was realizing that he was getting to be bigger than the majority of the vessels in the potter's house. Are there people that do that in the world, that they start thinking they're bigger and better, and eventually they kind of start to puff their chest out a little bit, and they walk around with this big old puffy chest because they're just better than everybody? Nobody really likes to be around that kind of person. Clay did not know that. Clay was focused on being the biggest, best vase that clay could be. And while the potter was forming and had his hand in the work, clay was forming to what clay wanted to be, not necessarily listening to what the potter had planned. Do we know any vases in our society? Sometimes you get the stars on TV become vases. Maybe there's some sports figures. Maybe there's people in our own schools and our own lives that become these vases. And eventually, they're not always the most fun to be around. But man, clay was excited. He'd become this nice big vase. And he says, man, if my friends in the field could see me now. He says, I have arrived. This is the life that I was meant to be. Now, what he didn't see was, without his eyes, didn't know the potter had something in his hand. Now, this is something called a needle tool. I don't know if you can see from where you are. It's an extremely sharp needle. I taught ceramics at Mays High School. I would have 30 to 32 kids in each class, and they all had a needle tool. You can imagine how dangerous that was. Clay did not realize the danger of what was in the potter's hand, but the potter says, yeah, you're a nice vase, but that's not what I had planned for you. So he took this needle. Ouch. He cut him off. Now, have you ever been cut before? It doesn't feel too good to be cut. I don't think anybody really likes that. There's different ways to be cut. You can be cut physically. You can be cut emotionally. Clay did not like that and says, you know what, Potter? I've been doing everything that you've told me to do. And then you come and you cut me like that, he says. I was laying peacefully out in my field with my friends, and you came and picked me up. You brought me into this shop. You formed me into this vase, and now you went and cut me like that. I am not going to let you in. Sometimes as humans we get hurt, family, sometimes by God, and we do our best to cut people out of our lives. Now remember, the potter can only work on clay if the hands can go inside, and clay has recognized that and says, I'm just going to cut the potter out. If I close myself off, that potter can no longer get his hand inside to work. Now, I don't know if you in the front row remember this name. I'm sure a lot of the adults do. Laura Ingalls Wilder. When I think of that name, I think of the old stories, kind of Cowtown. And the ceramic used there was something called a jug. We have milk jugs. I don't know if many households have clay jugs anymore. But clay jugs have a very, very small opening, and they are made to ferment things. So when a liquid ferments, it does not go quick. So it is a jug with a small opening. You stick a cork in it, set it in a basement, in a cellar, and that liquid inside, in theory, goes bad. Or in some people's minds, gets better. But what happens when we have those bad thoughts that clay has and we bottle them up inside? Nothing good usually comes out of those. Clay didn't know that. Clay just didn't want the potter to be in. And so he formed into a jug and said, you know what, potter? Now you can't get inside. I'm done with you. I'm done with what you wanted. I'm just going to be a jug, and I will be happy. And he kicked the potter out. So the potter respected him and says, okay, I'm going to take my time away here, and I'll let you have your sour thoughts and see what happens. Well, eventually, clay started getting bored just spinning on the wheel. The potter had not been touching clay, so he didn't have eyes, could not see if the potter was still there, and got lonely and says, potter, if you're there, please come back. I'll let you in. Just come back. I'm kind of bored sitting here spinning. And as you can see, the potter never really left. But he had something in his hand. Clay couldn't see it. And the potter came back with a sharp, ouch. and cut clay off again. Man, that just made clay mad. I invite you back in, and the first thing you do is you cut me. He says, I'm kind of tired of getting cut. Says, I'm willing to listen now. I'm going to be anything you want me to be. Now, clay also had heard of what a pitcher was. He says, you know, I could be a pitcher. Pitchers are good. They're used often. He says, yeah, being a pitcher would be good. Now, I grew up in the Mennonite church, and one of our big things that is kind of taught is the acts of service. Now, we don't live in a society anymore that has servants. However, Jeremiah in that time, they likely would have. But we do have something called servers. If you go to Olive Garden or Chili's or something, we have servers there. And they walk around with pitchers and they fill our cups up. He says, you know what? I'm going to be a pitcher. I'm going to be the best pitcher that's ever served anything. The act of service is good, but when it's done with that attitude, it's not always the best. Now, there's one thing that a pitcher has that cannot be made on the spinning wheel, which is, well, two things, I guess. There's a spout and there's the handle. So when they make a pitcher, the main thing is a spout to pour that water in. There are many types of spouts. You'll see all different forms. That's kind of one thing that a potter has. It sets them apart, is how they make spouts. Now, the next thing is putting a handle on. And if you ever do pottery, make sure the handle does not go on this side. It should probably be across from that spout. So the clay is extremely happy. He's now some kind of pitcher. And he says, you know what? Finally, I have reached the point to where I need to be. Not what I wanted, but I'm happy. However, the potter had a familiar tool to all of you in his hand, picked it up. Clay didn't see it coming, but the potter says, you know, I don't think I'm ready for you to be a pitcher. And cut him off. Now, clay is no... doesn't have a brain, but he's a little bit intelligent, and says, that pile of clay over there is a lot bigger than what I'm having here, so I better figure this game out with the potter before there's nothing left. He says, you know, I've also heard of something called a bowl. Bowls are good. They're used often. He says, yeah, I'll be a bowl. So the potter went. Didn't have much work to do after being a pitcher, having that same kind of form in the belly. Now, the thing with a bowl is it's extremely wide open. Do we have any people in our society that are extremely wide open? Have you ever tried to hide something in a bowl from your parents? It's like, I don't want to eat my broccoli. I'm going to hide it in my bowl. It's not usually going to work too well, okay? There are people like that, you know, the secrets are not always the best gift. But Clay said, you know what? Yeah, a bowl would be good. I think I'm going to be this bowl. He says, yeah. He says, Potter, if you want me to be a bowl, that's fine, because I will be anything except a mug. I don't want to be a mug. There's thousands of mugs in this world. I want to be special. I want to be unique. Just leave me here as a bowl. Because being a mug, I'd just blend in. But the potter picked up that famous tool and cut clay off. To where there was a place where now if you're looking here, you may not even be able to see it because there's just not much clay left. And the clay says, okay, Potter, I think the next step is it's just going to, you're going to take me off this wheel and I'm going to be a pile on the front of your wheel, so I will just be whatever. He says, you know what, if you want me to be a mug, I will be a mug. Just make sure that I am used. I want to be useful. I don't want to be a piece of clay sitting on the front of your wheel that will later be recycled, mixed in with other clods. And the potter says, you know, clay, being a mug is not too bad. He says, you know, the mug is the most used vessel by the humans. Says, if you're a vase, you usually get a flower put in you, and you sit on the table. You look pretty. But other than that, you're not very useful. If you're a jug, it's even worse. You just sit in a basement, under a stairway, down in a cellar. You never even see the sun. So as if you're a pitcher, you get use, but it's not often. Not like a mug. So bowls get used often. But he says a mug is extremely special. As humans, there's only really one form from the potter's house that we put in our mouths. Now, I don't know if that means much to you, but if you think about what humans put in our mouths, it's not just anything, unless you're a 5-year-old boy. It is learning about the world. He says, you know, we use mugs in our house. We each have our mug that we use for the day or for the week. Just run some water through it and clean it up. He says, being a mug is great. So Clay says, okay, Potter, you talked me into it. I will be your mug. And so he agreed. They finally came together and said, your destiny is to be in a cupboard with lots of other mugs, but you will still be this special piece. And so the potter cleaned up all the slip, all the water, and got Clay, who is now mug, ready. And this piece of clay says, man, I have arrived. This is great. I am now a mug. And he thought he was done. Now, with this mug, in theory, you can drink out of it. Did anybody want to try to drink out of this mug yet? What is missing in this mug? Yeah, a handle. I guess we could call it a cup, but we'll throw a handle on here. That comes later. You have to wait about a day to add a handle. So this cup here, it'll hold water. It's not falling out like the clay, the clod would have. It's still in there. You can pour out of it. But something's missing. But Clay did not know that. So the potter took Clay, put him on the shelf, and let him dry. Now in the pottery world, your clay has to dry 100% before you throw it in the kiln. Now the kiln is the big oven that the potter cooks the wares in. But remember, Clay does not aware of that, does not know what that whole process is. So he's sitting there. A day passes, 2 days, 3 days. Depends on the humidity. It takes usually about a week to dry. And finally, the potter came back and picked Clay up and looked at it. Says, yeah, I think you're ready. And he was excited because he was being picked up again. You know, they have no eyes. They're sitting in a room, don't know what's going on. And the potter took him to this big box, stuck him in, and closed the door. Now, this big box, when the door's closed, there's no light getting in. So he says, this is different than what I'm used to. And all of a sudden, he hears the little poking around in the box, and it starts to get warm. Now, these days in Kansas, we start at about 95 degrees on an average day. Not many people have that. I would say Clay probably starts around, let's say, 75 degrees, and it starts getting warmer and warmer. At 212 degrees is when all the remaining water is extracted out, becomes boiling. If there's any water left, it will explode. So the potter has to be extremely careful, and he knows when to put clay in. Well, that kiln starts getting hotter and hotter and hotter. And finally, clay's just like, I just can't take this. Everything's turning red. The air turns red. It's at 1,953 degrees, and clay says, I cannot take this anymore. And he hears a noise, and it shuts off. And finally, things start cooling down. The red turns into black, starts cooling down, and man, clay says, I could not have taken that anymore. The potter opens the door, and he looks down at himself. And he looks different. He sounds different. A change has been made in the fires of his life. He starts like this, and after a fire, he comes out more beautiful and stronger. Kind of like the fires that we have to go through. Sorry, I always get emotional. But we serve a God that will always put us through fire just to make us stronger, to make us more beautiful, more useful, if we just listen and do what God has planned for us, not what we have planned. Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, the potter of all potters, we give thanks that we are your clay and that you never throw us away, that you remold us and make us more beautiful than we can ever imagine. We give thanks for that promise at work in us and among us and through us. And may we always know that you hold us in the palms of your divine hands. And now receive our lives afresh and anew. May our time, our talent, and our treasure glorify you and bless others. For we offer this prayer in your most holy name. Amen. The ushers will now come and wait upon us as the morning offering is received. Back if you'd like, or you can stay there too. Do what's most comfortable for you.
I still remember when I heard you call me by name. I'd follow you anywhere, knew I could trust you in anything. But now sorrow beats down on me, waiting for you to come through. I'm all alone with my questions, I'm dry and cracked open, I thirst for you. And as I fall apart, come flood this desert heart. Fall like the rain, living water. And I know your way is best. Lord, help me find. My world. so out of control. And nail-scarred hands tell the story of love that will never let go of me. Through sunshine and rain, afraid of what you're making me. My world is breaking me. Your love is shaping me. And now the enemy is afraid of what you're making me. I fall apart. Come flood this day.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. That's beautiful. It's beautiful. One of the reasons why we take communion is because the clay is naturally resistant. You heard Isaac say that. The clay is naturally resistant to the hands of the potter. But the potter gently works with the clay. And communion is our consent. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. And if you're like me, we need more grace to say a deeper yes. So we serve an open table here at Chapel Hill. Anybody and everybody is welcome. And let me say what our spiritual father, Father John Wesley, always said. If you're an atheist here today, I encourage you to partake. If you're an agnostic, this table is for you. This is for anybody and everybody, as we seek to live in the hands of the potter. So if you have not yet received a prepackaged communion, the ushers have them available. Just raise your hand and they'll be happy to bring one to you. So that my prayer might be our prayer together, we join in the ancient prayer called the Great Thanksgiving. What's beautiful about this? It's not ours. It belongs to the universal church. And we participate with Christians all around the world offering this same prayer today. So please follow along according to the screens and participate enthusiastically, please. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, it is good, it is joyful to always and everywhere thank you, Abba, the potter. the one who is exceedingly able to reshape us and remold us according to your will and way. And so we praise you. We adore you. We magnify your holy name as together we say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is Jesus who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for death, he took bread and he gave you thanks. And he broke it. He shared it and he said, Take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. As often as you eat this bread, do so in memory of me. When the supper had ended, our Lord Jesus took the chalice and he gave you thanks. And he shared it. And he said, Take and drink, each of you. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do so in memory of me. We ask, O God, that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon every person in this sanctuary and upon those who are participating online, that your Holy Spirit would bear witness with our spirits that we are your children, that we belong to you, that we are your clay, that you love and embrace and treasure. Pour out your Spirit upon this act of Holy Communion, that you would consecrate these elements to become for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may participate in the sacraments filled with grace and goodness. We give thanks. We give thanks. We give thanks. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And now together we pray, as our Savior has taught us. Together we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I want to invite you to take your prepackaged communion, and as you open the bread, I want to invite you to hold the bread before you. And we'll wait just a moment so that we can all partake together. We are the body of Christ, beautifully arranged, incredibly diverse, but we are one with Christ and each other by God's design. So as you hold the bread, I want you to imagine that Jesus is serving you, and he is saying, This is my body, the bread of life for you. Take and eat and give God thanks. And as you open the fruit of the vine, hold it before you, please. And I want you to see in your mind's eye Jesus himself saying to you and to me, This is my blood poured out for you, for forgiveness, for peace. Take and drink and give God thanks. And now as we close this communion, let's have a moment of silent prayer. In response to Isaac's powerful word, what is it that you're taking with you today as we walk into this new week? Following the service today, we are going to have a time of fellowship. That's why we call that room Fellowship Hall. Our youth have some extra donuts, and if you make a donation for the donuts, it helps the youth with their mission work. So thank you for supporting them and indulging in a good donut as well. I think the last I knew, they're from Krispy Kreme, aren't they? Yes. So, but in the church, all fat has been removed by the power of the Spirit. And Pat and Dick Dalton, are you back there? Would you stand, please? These two are here at 7:15 to 7:20 every Sunday morning preparing the coffee. We don't do coffee machines where they use that terribly tasting coffee. They make the coffee. And so this is our opportunity to say thank you for your service. We are deeply grateful. So as you enter into this new week, before I pronounce the benediction, I pray that you are fully aware, as beautifully illustrated by Isaac, that you are God's masterpiece. You are an incredible work of God, fully loved, deeply treasured. That's who you are in Christ. Do you believe it? Do you accept it? Do you embrace it? Well, come on now. There's got to be a Baptist or two among us. If this were a Baptist church, I would not have to prompt an amen, would I? So please stand if you're able. Go forth, sisters and brothers, in peace. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon us and make us whole. Amen and amen. Let's sing Go With God.
Face with a song in your heart and the promise of grace.